Greetings to all the delegates at APICON 2018. I'm Dr. Jagadish Jamboti. I'm a renal physician at Fiona Stanley Hospital, Perth. Fiona Stanley Hospital, Perth was commissioned in 2014 and is one of the largest state-of-the-art acute university teaching hospital. It's my great pleasure to be sharing with you recent developments in the area of renal transplantation. The first successful renal transplantation in humans happened in 1954, and that was a very masterly strategic occurrence because it was between two identical twins, or homozygous twins as we call them. That means they were able to bypass the whole landmine of immune intolerance, like the HLA matching, the tissue typing, the ABO incompatibility, and the need for long-term immunosuppression. To transplant across these barriers, one has to develop ways and means of detecting the antibodies and how to overcome them. And we have come a long way from the days in 1964 when Paul Terasaki introduced the complement-dependent cytotoxicity, or the CDC testing for detecting HLA antibodies. Now we have got flow cytometry. Now we have got single antigen beads that can detect single HLA antigens. For the immunosuppression, we use calcineurin inhibitors like cyclosporin, and the introduction of cyclosporin in the 1970s heralded a new era of cyclosporin, which made more and more transplants possible. And you have got mammalian target of rapamycin, or mTOR inhibitors like sirolimus, everolimus, that have been added to the armamentarium. And then of course we use corticosteroids as standard triple immunosuppression. A recent study, Harmony study, showed that we can withdraw steroids very early in the piece in very low sensitized or very low immunologic risk patients. The incidence of post-transplant diabetes has been around 15 to 30% in our transplant recipients, and we have looked at various ways and means of reducing this incidence. Also, increased cancer surveillance has led to early detection and preventing certain high-risk groups getting a transplant and then running the risk of developing cancers. In 1971, a new virus was discovered called BK virus. This has led to screening strategies, to surveillance strategies, and reducing immunosuppression at the appropriate time, and institution of antiviral agents to get rid of the BK virus in the transplant recipients. The donor pool has improved and increased in the last decade because now we have started accepting deceased donors after cardiac or circulatory death, DCD donors, as we say. So the addition of the DCD donors has enormously expanded the pool and has made more number of transplants possible. And also, the use of pulsatile pump perfusion has made it possible to reduce the incidence of delayed graft function in our transplant recipients. In 1993, Banff classification was introduced. We have now Banff classification for liver transplant pathology, for heart transplant pathology, and so on and so forth. And kidney area has led the way all along. What this leads to is a worldwide common way of reporting and understanding the kidney allograft pathology. And then, of course, we are always thrilled to think about xenotransplantation or transplantation from animal donors, because there could be theoretically an endless supply of organs and there will be no donor shortage on the face of this earth at all. So a lot of new excitement, developments, and progress in the area of renal transplantation. I'm very eager to catch up with you at APICON 2018. Till then, bye.